So the first comment I'd make about manufacturing strategy or operation strategy is it's part of business strategy. In fact, one thing that I always react to negatively, if I hear in organizations where they say, that's not a strategic issue, that's an operations issue, I get like hives. I get my blood pressure goes up. Because it represents, all too often, too common, a fundamental misunderstanding of how operations contributes to the overall business strategy of a company. And a business strategy of any enterprise is really made up of the intersection of a whole series of functional strategies. There's R&D strategy, marketing strategies, you know, financial strategies, operation strategies. It's how those come together. You execute your business strategy through what you do with your functional strategies. That's where the rubber meets the road. And the key here is to make sure those are aligned with your overall business strategy, but also connected to each other. You can't make up an operation strategy in absence of what's happening with the overall business strategy and without what's thinking about the other strategies of the organization, whether it's legal or financial or marketing, et cetera. Fundamentally to all strategies, whether you're talking business strategy or operation strategy, is a couple of key points. So the first is that you've got to make choices, and we'll talk more about that in a moment. But in essence, what an operation strategy is, if I had to kind of give you a concise definition, it's a coherent and consistent set of policies regarding your operations, things like where you put your plants, what technologies you use, who you hire, et cetera, that are designed, and I use the word designed intentionally, that is, it's purposeful to give you an edge in the market. All strategy is about an edge. It's always about competitors. You can't talk about strategy in the absence of competition. That's why we have strategies. If you think about your Saturday morning tennis game, you know, hit to Joe's backhand may be your strategy. That's because you think Joe has a weak backhand, presumably. That's a strategy. We all engage in strategies. But it always has to do with competitive interactions and always thinking about what's the edge. And so I always start a discussion about operating strategies around what are the operating capabilities we're trying to create that give us an edge. That's the question that has to be answered in every operation strategy, whether it's your operation strategy as an organization, whether it's your client strategy, it's always about the capabilities that give you an edge. Now, an operation strategy itself is made up of a lot of decisions. If you think about in your organization or think about your clients' organizations, there's decisions being made all the time about things like capacity, how much capacity should we keep, what are our capacity policies, where do we put our plants, you know, what's the design of our facilities look like, what kind of process technology we use, which obviously is one near and dear to your hearts, metrics, quality, inventory, production planning, human resources. Those things together, you think about operations as a system, those are the components of the system, and those are the decisions which together create the operation strategy. So capabilities to compete are never a function of just one thing. So, you know, if I ask an organization, how do you intend to compete with such and such a competitor? How do you intend to get a cost advantage? Or how do you intend to be more flexible or responsive? And they say, well, we're going to, you know, put our plant in this particular location. That alone is not a strategy. That's by itself, that's just a component. You have to think about the whole constellation of other things you do. Capabilities result from a constellation of decisions, and they have to be interrelated. They have to be coherent, and they have to be connected, and they have to reinforce each other. It's a system. And the essence of an operation strategy is creating that system. You're designing that system, and you're making sure the components fit together, and they reinforce each other. And that's what makes them hard, right? That's what makes them hard to copy. That's what gives them a certain power. They're hard to imitate. It's also important to have an explicit operation strategy because if you think about the kind of decisions I just listed there, they're often made in very different parts of the organization, different functional parts. And if you don't have a common framework, then everybody kind of goes off doing well-meaning, seemingly rational things, but they don't fit together, and then you don't get the capability. Now, another really important part of effective operation strategies is it often means when companies are doing operation strategy effectively, it often means they're doing unique things. They're often doing things which at first glance seem like, wow, that's crazy and ridiculous. In fact, operation strategy often leads and should often lead to real innovation in the operations. And just some examples here. Let's go back to Federal Express, founded in the early 70s. When Fred Smith posed the idea of saying, we're going to have overnight parcel delivery, and the way I'm going to do that is I'm going to have a centralized hub and spoke. I'm going to have one location, in his case it was Memphis, and then every parcel is going to be flown into Memphis, regardless of where it's originating and where it's going to go. We're going to sort them there, and then they're going to be flown back to the location. So folks were like, wait a minute, if you're sending a parcel from Boston to Worcester, you're going to put it on an airplane, you're going to fly it to Memphis, then you're going to put it on an airplane and you're going to fly it back to Boston, and you're going to drive it out to Worcester. And folks said, that's insane. But it wasn't, because actually by doing a hub and spoke that way, he completely changed the economics of the business. He created scale economy that allowed him to do things that almost nobody else could do. In fact, at that time, nobody else could do. So as a system, it was very efficient. But it was very new, and people said it was a bad idea. Apple, if you look at what was written about Apple when they announced they were doing retail stores, it is hard to find a positive comment. Computer companies having stores, there was only one computer company who had their own stores. You remember who that was? Gateway. And do you remember what happened to them? They went out of business. So folks were not, because folks were saying, but Gateway did it and they went out of business. Apple's going to have stores. That's just a terrible idea. Completely misunderstood that the retail store for Apple was part of building their brand. They were trying to create and use that as an extension of their brand and trying to create a unique brand experience. And Apple stores, retail stores, have been incredibly successful, not only in terms of building the brand, but just as entities in themselves. It's an incredibly successful retailer. Zara in the apparel business, the fashion apparel business, vertical integration. So Zara has their own plants. At a time when every other company was selling their plants, outsourcing their production as far away as they could, Zara was, for Europe, was actually putting their plants in Spain. And that was going against the grain. But it enabled them to be far more responsive. Their strategy was to be able to do replenishment within the season and respond very quickly, this whole concept of fast fashion. It was different because they had a different strategy. Or IKEA, combining the store and the warehouse and turning their customer into stock pickers, which is what we are. When we go to, we don't realize that we kind of went in there and we're like unpaid stock pickers. And that's why they keep their costs low, right? Nobody else had ever done that before. And so one of the things about operation strategy is it's not about following the herd. It's not about doing what everybody else is doing. It's about thinking uniquely about what's our unique value proposition? What's our strategy? What's making us different? And then how do we configure our operations to go after that? And that often means going against the grain. And that's why I get very nervous about when I see these benchmarking studies that talk about here's what everybody's doing, here's the trend, this is what everybody's doing, you should be doing it too. It's like if everybody's doing this, you should be doing this. Because it's really hard to compete if everybody's doing this and you have to go in a different direction. The best competition is no competition. The other key principle here, which I mentioned, is trade-offs. So an operating system is just like every other kind of system you can think of. It can't be designed to do all things equally well. Now think about a car. Think about if you were in the car business, you were designers at Ford or General Motors or Volkswagen or Honda, and you were asked to design a car. Your first question would be, what kind of vehicle do you want? I mean, what do you want it to do well? Do you want it to be a very fast car? Do you want it to handle well? Do you want it to carry a lot of things? Do you want it to be extremely fuel efficient? Do you want it to be able to go off-road, the back roads of the Himalayas and survive? Do you want it to be extraordinarily reliable? Do you want it to be cheap? What's the priority? And if you were just told, everything's important. Make it go from 0 to 60 in 4 seconds, get 40 miles to the gallon, carry a family of 12 with a dog, and be able to go through, dry riverbeds in Kazakhstan, et cetera, If you tried to design that vehicle, what do you think you'd get?
Ford
C-Max. Yeah, Ford C-Max. Something that doesn't work well, right? Something that has very little appeal. It's got to. I don't know the inside joke on the C-Max. Okay,
but
you all had to buy the C-Max. Okay. How was it as a car? And that's a process that occurs because this is the hard part of strategy, any strategy, whether it's operation strategy or business strategy. Choice is hard. So strategy is not a complex problem. It's a hard problem. There's a difference, right? It's a hard problem because choice is really hard. Choice means, you know, I can have vanilla ice cream or chocolate, but I have to decide. And if I can't decide, I get swirl, and we all know nobody likes swirl, right? Because it's neither chocolate nor vanilla. But it's hard because actually there can be a couple of different ways to compete. There could be that are equally valid. But ultimately, if you kind of go back to some of the examples of companies I gave before, IKEA, Apple, Federal Express, there's things they do really well. Federal Express is incredibly good at getting packages to you overnight. They're not cheap. Right, Federal Express is never going to be the cheapest carrier. That's not what they're about. IKEA is very cheap, but they're not about convenience. You know, you have to drive to one that's somewhere far out where they can build a massive place. It's typically, unless you happen to get lucky and live near one, they're typically, you know, it's not convenient that way. It's not convenient to put the stuff in your car and drive it home, but it's cheap. So it's about choice and deciding what choice is best, and then being very systematic about designing your operating system to continually reinforce those. And so again, it's kind of three simple questions. And these are questions that you can ask for your organization, but I'd also encourage you to ask them about your customers and your clients. You know, how should they be thinking about these? Because I think you're enabling their operation strategies. As key suppliers of a process technology, you're a key enabler. And you have to understand how they're thinking about these issues to understand how your technology fits into their problem space. So, pretty simple. What edge are we trying to achieve in the marketplace? What are the most important operating capabilities that contribute to that edge? And then third, how do we configure our operating system to create those capabilities? So what are the levers that are available? Kind of go back to the framework. It's a system, right? I think one of the key levers is exactly what you do. I don't think you get those fundamental changes without fundamental process innovation. I don't think it's a matter of saying, well, we can outsource this, or maybe we can improve our processes, or we'll improve our planning processes. I think that's important. They should be doing that. But I think it's more fundamental. I think this is the time for some more fundamental change in process technology and the manufacturing strategies that go with it. And if you look at the history, and this is something I spent a lot of my career looking at, because I think people underappreciate process innovation and what it can do to industry economics and competition. Process innovation can truly transform industry economics. We have a long history of this. I mean, go back. The assembly line in autos completely changed the auto industry. The planar process in semiconductors, electric arc furnaces in steel, internet everywhere, but particularly retail. The retail industry today is totally different. And 3D printing in fabrication industries is starting to, or is very likely to. That's all process innovation, and it fundamentally transforms an industry. And those radical process technologies tend to be part of new manufacturing strategies. So assembly line in autos was all about being part, it wasn't just the assembly line. It was a fundamental transformation of how companies were competing. It was Ford, the low-cost, mass-produced car. Electric arc furnaces brought in the mini mills, which came to dominate the steel industry. Okay, but so it wasn't one thing. They were part of a broader change in strategy and a broader change in operation strategy. So this is challenging for you because that's what you sell. You're selling, partly what you're doing is you're selling process innovation. Now, there's probably two things. There's several things you probably run into all the time, and these may be very familiar to you as you try to get folks to adopt process technology. I think the first two may be fairly familiar to you. I mean, the first one is the obvious, you know, installed capacity base, which is if you're trying to sell something new and they've got a bunch of old stuff, they prefer to use the old stuff before they buy something new. Now, that goes away a little bit if you've got enough change where the old stuff becomes obsolete, then they have to buy anyway. But that's always a challenge to get folks to buy new stuff if they've got plenty of old stuff. And depending on where you are in the cycle in the industry, if there's excess capacity or not, and biologics definitely go through periods of excess capacity and now extremely tight capacity. There's extremely tight capacity now, so people need to buy. But when there's excess capacity, they're like, hey, I got a bunch of tanks. You know, I'm going to use those because my marginal cost looks to be zero if I just use those tanks. The second is risk aversion, right? If you try something new, if your client tries something new and it doesn't work, that feels like the kind of thing you could get fired for. If you're trying something old that has worked but is not necessarily optimal, it doesn't feel like the kind of thing you could get fired for. I think that really depends on the kind of company culture. But again, operations in pharmaceuticals has historically been all about risk aversion. You know, don't mess it up. Now, even though sometimes the don't mess it up strategy leads to messing up, right? Because if you're ultra conservative, you can actually wind up with not enough capacity, you can wind up with the wrong kind of capacity, et cetera. But you're selling into that, right? You're selling into a risk-averse climate. The third thing is something a little more subtle, and I want to spend another minute talking about this. It's what we sometimes call in my field the new technology obsolete organization phenomenon. And this has to do with the fact that new technology requires organizations to change. And sometimes the problem with organizations is they can't adopt new technology because the way the organization is set up, the way they think about the problems, what their capabilities are, that's the part that's obsolete. And the new technology, it just can't find a base in the organization. The organization can't make use of it. Let me give you a great example from some research that my colleagues have done on the auto industry. So autos, this is not about manufacturing. This is really more the design process. And we've done a lot of studies of this as well, going back to automation in manufacturing plants and flexible manufacturing and IT. We've actually had dozens of really good studies to document this. But the auto one is really one of the most graphic ones for me. So as you may know, the design of autos has changed a lot in the last 20 years. There's a lot more completely a computer-aided design. You no longer... The car commercials always show crash test dummies banging into things. Realistically, that's not... The government still requires you to do that, but that's not how you test safety of a car. You do it completely through computer-aided simulation. It's much more accurate. You can predict head injuries through a computer simulation much better than you can through the dummies. Now, what's interesting in the auto industry is the software packages to do this, it's a standard package. Everybody basically adopted the same technology. And yet, what we found is dramatic differences in the impact of that technology on things like engineering productivity and cycle times and design quality. So it's a real interesting puzzle, which is, wait a minute, you all got the same tool, quite literally the same package with the same instructions from the same vendor who provided the same training. This company over here, they shorten their product development time, they get, you know, double their engineering productivity, they get much higher quality design. And this company here, you know, they get a 5% improvement. What accounts for that? What my colleagues who did the study found is that in the companies who got the benefit, they didn't just bring the technology in. They didn't plug and play it into their existing development process and their existing development strategy. They asked themselves, what does this new tool allow us to do that we couldn't do before? How might we use that to our advantage? And how do we reconfigure our organization to take advantage of that? So one of the things in this case, if you can do lots of simulation very quickly, so you can test the design in 2.5 days, okay, as opposed to, you know, several months, you can test a lot more designs. Right, but that means changing the way you do design early. You suddenly do this huge parallel development of multiple competing designs early as opposed to more sequential. That's just one of the examples. But it was a complete change in the way the organization worked. They completely overhauled their development process to take advantage of it.